Ladies and gentlemen, I guess we can get started. My name is Armughan Al-Haq. I'm the Manager of Program Development and Partnerships with WISE, Waterloo Institute for Sustainable Energy. And let me introduce you our guest speaker for today. Dr. Majid Sultani obtained his PhD from University of Waterloo in 2012. His research expertise include transport phenomena in different areas such as energy, bioenergy, and biological systems. He has been with Johns Hopkins University as a postdoc fellow since 2013. Dr. Sultani joined KN2C University of Technology in Tehran, Iran, last year as an assistant professor. He has taught courses in energy transport phenomena, energy transfer in buildings, renewable energy, and HVAC systems. He has published more than 40 journal papers and over 60 conference papers. Currently, he's the director of the HVAC and Energy Lab at KN2C University and the Department of Energy of Iran. So ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together for Dr. Majid Sultani. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody, and thank you, Armughan, for your introduction. It's my honor to come back to Waterloo and give a lecture at the WISE Institute. Let's start the presentation. The title is Natural Ventilation of Buildings Using a New Design of Wind Catcher to Decrease Energy Consumption in Windy Regions. And I think it makes sense for the word windy regions in Canada. We are going to conclude that is it possible to have this system in Canada or not. Look at the picture. Any of the audience have seen this from the maybe in North America, you can find some in Santa Fe in US or New Mexico. I haven't seen anything else in the North America, but have you had any chance to look at this kind of art in your life or not? Because it's very important. If you have seen from, you have no experience, okay. This works this way.
You could use the clicker if you want.
This one?
The other one, which is right on top.
Oh, I see. Okay, thank you. What is the wind catcher? It's good to start the word wind catcher or wind towers. I looked a lot actually during the last couple of years to see what's the origin of this word. In Persian or Farsi, they called Badgir. Exact translation of wind catcher. But these days, because some other countries like German and Spain are going to use this system a lot, the word wind tower, if you search in Google, goes in top instead of wind catcher or Badgir. And what is the simple definition of wind catcher? If you look at this picture, for example, this one is in Egypt, Cairo, and the other one in the middle part of Iran, Yazd. And I think the number of wind catchers or wind towers, the highest number of them you can find in the middle part of Iran. I will show you in the map. But simply, it's the kind of column with different shape and different sizes. And they installed in top part of the building and mostly in the direction of the wind. And this is the main idea of this new design, wind direction. And still, they used in new buildings. For example, if you look at some of them, all of them in Iran, and the next picture, next slide. This is the, at this one, Taft City again is part of Yazd. Kashan in the south part of Tehran. And it's interesting for people who know the climate about Tehran. If you stand in the middle of the Tehran, go 20 kilometers in the north, is a big mountain. And if you go to 30, 40 kilometers on the south, you will see a hot area. Therefore, this is the in the south part of Tehran. Kashan is a small city there. Sirjan is a north, southeast, close to Pakistan and Afghanistan, Sirjan city in Kerman. And Ardistan, again, is a small city in the Yazd, middle part of, and all this area specification is having kind of windy region and also not that much water. But if we have a lot of water resources like Canada, we can add another system to this to use it in a, you know, kind of more efficient way. We can categorize, actually there is no standard yet about the wind catchers. We try to go and based on the research that we are going in the national lab, we are going to categorize based on the information that we got from all around the world. The first classification or categories we find is based on the performance of these tools or simply wind catchers. We categorize them to four categories. The first one is one-sided wind towers. This is actually part of the Yazd. A big province, but this is the small city in that province, Yazd. And if you look at them, one-sided wind towers, all of these wind catchers faced in the wind direction. We have one opening area, and the simple kind of performance of this wind catcher is that, catching the wind and then do some kind of process on it, depends on the situation. If we have kind of water resources, long days ago, they put a small, you know, amount of water. When air goes on top of the water, it has kind of, you know, thermodynamic property to use the sensible heat. And then by evaporation of that water, the air is cooled and then can be used in the, but if we don't have any resource of water, we can use just the energy of the wind and then bring it in the room or inside of the space that we have and use for any kind of residential or industrial processes. If we are going to increase the efficiency of the wind catcher, we go to the second category, which are called two-sided wind towers. Is almost the, we have the mirror image of the first one that I explained in the previous slide. We have double-sided, and one of them helps to bring the wind inside the space. And you know that because we are going to use energy efficiency in the system, we are not going to use any fan or electricity in this system. Therefore, the other part, for example, imagine wind goes this way. The next part of the, or the next side of the wind catcher helps to suck out the air. And this helps to have a continuous, you know, kind of airflow in the system. And for HVAC or any ventilation, you know, we need kind of mechanical force to have heat transfer, because when we are doing some kind of, I don't know, activity inside any closed space, we need to have fresh air. And this helps to bring in the air and then suck out the air. Therefore, we have kind of continuous. But again, if we measure the performance and efficiency of this system, it still is not high. But look at those pictures. It's about 300 to 700 years ago, some of them. And still, we have some kind of, you know, these buildings in center of Iran and other part of the Middle East. We have a few inside the Iran and other countries, not that much. They called 4, 6, and 8-sided wind towers. The main idea here is that we don't have any specific, because it's kind of external flow. We cannot, you know, have a specific path for the wind. Therefore, the main idea here is that if we have kind of windy region that there is no main, you know, regime or kind of pattern for the wind, because you are going to fix this on the top of the building, The main idea here is that if we can use the all direction of the wind, because you know in some regions, in different seasons, different hours of the day, you have different direction for the wind. Here the main idea is that how we can use different direction. And this is very kind of smart system, because if the direction of the wind changes, the inlet and outlet changes automatically. For example, maybe in the some season, this is the inlet, and the next part or other part of the this system is outlet. But if the direction of the wind changes, the inlet and outlet of the system change automatically. And if you really, we don't have that much, and if you look at the picture, it's very old, that one and also this one. We have cylindrical wind towers. This is the most advanced system that we had during the last couple of maybe centuries. They used cylindrical, and this performance with respect to the first one that I showed you in a very slide, very first slide, maybe the efficiency is doubled. And they are very good at that time, as I mentioned, but the main idea here is that how we can have better system than 300 or, you know, 400 years ago. Is there any way and any idea to do it better? And also, what is the limitation of all of this system? Before we go to the limitations of the system, I try to show you in this picture which part of the world actually still use this system. This is the, sorry, this is the Iran. I don't know the laser part. Okay. Okay, this part, as you may know, is the Iran in the Middle East. And all of these parts you can find kind of wind catcher or wind towers, but the focus is in this area. And as a matter of fact, maybe it's interesting for you, still we cannot use any other system like HVAC systems and any other system because of the specific kind of weather situation that they have there. We have there. Therefore, still they use in a very, very new systems, kind of this. And here in other part of the Middle East and also in Egypt, but I, as I said before, Spain, and if you search Germany and also the part of the US in this maybe two last decades, trying to use this because there is no expenses or any cost for you. When you put as an architectural of your building, you don't need to do anything, you know, in terms of energy, electricity, or maintenance. There is nothing, just the capital cost that you paid for that. And by the way, some people believe that it gives some kind of art to the building or the, I don't know, in terms of civil engineering, they said that that's good. That makes better instead of, you know, having some solid, you know, feature for the building. And this is totally new in some part, and for some of them, this the first, very first picture here is in Dubai, in Doha, Qatar, very new one, in Bahrain, in Afghanistan, Herat, this is old one. Hyderabad, Pakistan, again, it's an old one, and in Jordan. And I haven't had my, all of my files here to put some new in the other part of the Europe. But for sure, if you're interested, you can find a lot. What is the limitation of the previous and the problems with the other systems and previous systems that we discussed in any of those four categories? The first one, if you look at them, we have lots of problems with the maybe a small birds, insect, and also these days air pollution maybe comes directly to the building or the space. The other limitation, if you look at them, as I mentioned, is a solid part of the building. You cannot change anything on them if you have any idea or in the different hours, because we have, you know, kind of different solar beam from the sun, if we have kind of different direction for the rain or snowy days or anything like that, like this region, we cannot do anything. And because there is no calculation based on, you know, 800 years ago, 8,000 years ago, There were no optimization for the shape. Therefore, if you do the same, we have to see most part of the air actually go in the kind of short circuit and doesn't go inside the building. We have waste of air that we catch and we are interested to send it inside the building. And also, in the region with very low wind speed, there is no performance or efficiency for that. Therefore, we test and modeled most of the pictures that I showed you inside the simulation of, maybe some of you have background in computational fluid and dynamics or finite element modeling or any other simulation in the small models. For example, we did one of the models in the Western lab to see what's the best performance of the external air around the any wind catcher. And we came up with this idea. We first of all, we can put kind of a screen or filter for some, you know, polluted area. And also, if you look at them, and I will explain in the next picture, we have three different parts inside the column. We call this part as a head, this a screen, and this as a column. And we put inside that some windows to control the airflow. And I'm going to explain in the next slide. The head, as I mentioned, in the previous models is fixed. There is no difference between head and column in the previous models. But the main idea here is that can we have any control on the airflow? If we separate head from the column, we can manage the rate of airflow, and also if we have any possibility to move around, we can change the direction of the face, forward face of the or head of the wind catcher to catch the maximum amount of wind. And also for the control of the system, if control of the head or entrance of the wind catcher is not easy, we can go with some simple tools like window to open and close totally the wind catcher in very specific situation. And here is the very detailed explanation about the new models. And actually, we are going to test this. We are looking for some partnership to do this in maybe Ottawa or Toronto, because in energy sector, they are interested to see, is it possible? Because as I will show you in the very last slide, you will see there is a big potential here in Canada for using this, specifically in the summertime. And also there are some kind of parallel situation for heating in the winter time or fall. Therefore, we are going to see, is it possible to use that? And we are going to patent this. And we just published very preliminary result of this in the, I believe, in Energy Sustainable, Journal of Sustainable Energy. And they asked for the second part, which is the simulation and tests. But we are waiting for to see, is it going success to be any success to be in as a patent before we publish the main result or not. This is the screen, as I explained, and head. The main idea is that if we put some holes in the column, and there is an easy way to move, you know, in this direction, we can control the air coming inside the wind catcher. And also, if this can be done manually or automatically, and there is a kind of cost for automatically control this, there is an easy way to do to put some kind of windows here at the very end of the column, and we can control the airflow coming inside the space. And when we test this one, we came up with some idea. Again, if you look at the any kind of this entrance face of the air coming inside the room like this one, what is the best shape? What is the best cross-sectional area? square, rectangle, or if you do any test, you will see that the best one is circular, because you have to pay less in the mechanical room as a fan, you know, cost. You can choose, you can actually buy a smaller fan, and if you have a bigger fan, you can control the speed with a lower speed, and again, much less cost. You can transfer the better and the high efficiency, you can have the high efficiency system in terms of cost. Therefore, we saw that is, again, applicable for the our system to go to this one. But I will back to the previous slide to see how difficult is that in terms of maybe, because this is not a, just, you know, one specific area. If you are going to set up this in the building, you have to, you know, talk about that in your group as a civil engineering, material science, mechanical engineering, and also the people who take care about the comfort area inside the rooms, inside the spaces. Therefore, we cannot just go as a, you know, very ideal either, idea and say, okay, this is very good in terms of efficiency of the fan or transfer of the air. We have to discuss with them, and we find out installing this in the top of the building and movement of this is not easy. We need to look at other parameters for this purpose wind tower. For example, we have to, again, look at the people who take care about the comfort condition of the internal space and ask them, how much air do you need for you know, air change and also the comfort condition inside the room. And we have to provide that and supply that amount of air that they need. Also, the dimension of the building and also the material. For sure, if you are going to have a building which is built based on the wood and you cannot have a very, very, you know, heavy wind catcher on top of the wood for that building, you have to discuss and see what's the best way to build a wind catcher, actually a wooden wind catcher or any other. Also, what is the dimension of the building? Because you may think if we have a wind catcher in the size half of the building, we can bring all of the load and of the building just based on the air we bring with the wind catcher, but it's not possible to. Therefore, we should have some kind of size match between the wind catcher and the building. And very important, what is the building security? For example, I don't know, we are allowed to use in the big malls or banks or any other, you know, offices. Maybe it's not easy because there is a very, you know, huge amount of space that people can go inside easily without any problem because there is no mechanical, they may find something for the security. It's not our problem, maybe. What is the solution for any of these? As I mentioned, we can use the same material for the building. We have to look at the air and weather condition. If we have windy, that's very good. If we have rainy or snowy, we should look at the erosion and corrosion inside. If we have some cities like, you know, capital city or big cities and we have pollution, we really have to think about the filtration of the air and something like that. And very important, these days people care about this very, you know, I see a lot of paper on this area and a lot of work in different company. Is it possible to use transparent material? If you are going to use that, we can bring both air for air conditioning and also natural light instead of having kind of, you know, electrical. And this used before in some area, at least in Iran, as I saw before. And also, the main idea of this kind of new design is this one. Is it possible to have wind tower with a rotating head or not? And because of that, we came up with this idea. Because if you have the rectangular cross section or square cross section, you have to, you know, turn the whole head and column of the wind catcher, and it's not easy. And again, for that one, you have to spend a lot of money for some system to, because it's not light instrument. It's a heavy one and it's not easy to turn it around. But for this one, we find out in very preliminary result, if we use this system, and by the way, the cross section has to be circular, the head can easily be moved around even with the wind energy, and simply we can provide that without paying that much. And in our test, we find out it's very successful, because when we installed a wind vane here around this one, we saw that whenever the wind direction changes, this part changes automatically, and it's very helpful. But again, we can go and move forward to have the better and optimized form for this one. And again, we can see the detail of this. Everything is similar. Again, we can have movement of this head inside these holes in the column. We can have, again, windows here to control the airflow coming inside the space. And we can have, in the air opening, kind of a screen or filter. What's the application? Based on our study and a lot of other studies in the literature, we find out, at least till now, there are three possibilities for having wind catcher inside any space. When we say space, it can be any residential, any industrial, big malls, and even complex sports. Sometimes when you go inside the complex sport, and if you ask them, they put a lot of money for air conditioning. But still, you don't feel good in the complex sport because there is a lot of activity. And if you look at the any standard like ASHRAE, American Society of Heating and Refrigeration Engineers, you'd see even the amount of energy that they put for changing the air and bring air, fresh air inside those spaces is a lot, but people don't feel good. When you leave the complex space and go to the outside, you feel how much difference is between these two. And based on this and the last slide I will show you, we have a very good idea for this one. The very simple idea is this one, having a wind tower for bringing fresh air, and also the output can be anything like windows, doors, or we can have a wind tower and a solar chimney or air heater. And this is very good, the second option for climate like Canada that we have, very cold and very hot in different seasons. The last one, which makes a little complex, is having more than one. The simple one is two wind towers, but we can have more than that, wind towers. And if we have more than one wind towers, the balance of the system is very important, because if you don't have a good balance, the performance of them maybe is worse than these two, the first one and the second one. Simply here is we put, for example, the new design or the old wind tower here to catch as much as air and fresh air that we can, bring it to here after having the, you know, kind of transport phenomena that happens here between fresh air and the kind of return air or old condition that have here. And after transferring of the load, we can, you know, have this air as an outdoor or bring it back to some mechanical system, because most of the time you have another mechanical system as well, because this is a very passive system, is not active. You have to have another system. You have to have another system to use the best situation of this passive system, because you cannot just rely on the passive system in the air conditioning system. In the second one that I explained, and it's very good based on our calculation and also the literature for country or air condition like and weather condition like Canada, is this one. If you put in the wind direction a wind tower or wind catcher, you can catch, again, based on the performance of this one, as much as air and bring it here. If windows, doors, and other exits cannot help, you can have, because, for example, these days it's very hot, you can design a very simple system, kind of double glazed window and wall, and this helps to make the air very close to this warm. And as you know, if we have cold or fresh air here, the density of that is higher. And if we have this kind of solar radiation coming inside, it makes this air here close to this window hot and density is low. And by this difference between the densities, it helps to bring it out. And they called solar chimney and the performance of lots of work you can find in the literature. What's happened in winter time? In winter time, if you close this automatically, this helps to bring the fresh air that you need for, because you know that if we don't have fresh air, we don't have oxygen. And we cannot stay more than seconds inside any space. This helps to, and some very, very new systems use this as a preload, because this air can go to the mechanical systems and active systems, again, to decrease the amount of cost. Therefore, we can use as a preload, or if we have a lot of opening like this in the winter time, we can rely on that for heating of our systems. And the third system, which is very efficient, but we should be very careful about the installing and the point, because you have to solve an optimization problem to find out the best place for the wind catchers if you are going to have more than two or three wind towers. And the main idea is that we have to choose one of them or a few of them. The face of them should be in the direction of the wind, and the others in the opposite direction of the winds. Because these ones, again, based on the fundamental of fluid mechanics, helps to bring in as much as air which is possible, and then use the other wind towers in the opposite direction for as an exit of our system. Because if you don't have output or outlet in the boundary condition, you will decrease the amount of inlet. Therefore, this is very important. And with this idea, you may see this is very close to the second slide that I showed you. It was double-sided wind catcher. But the difference is that we have a large distance between inlets and outlets. And this brings another idea, which have a few in very, very old system. If you look at the literature, comes with this one. I searched a lot about these new tools. Some people called CAP, and some of them in the literature, dome, but most of them use the same word that we use in Persian, word as a kola farangi. It means CAP comes from the West. I don't know why people call that, but anyway, what's the main idea here? Two idea is with these new tools, if we call that CAP. With CAP, we can use a few windows and again control the output and also the input. And another idea, for example, for the big malls, if we can use transparent materials, we can bring a lot of natural light to the system. And in some malls, we saw this, but without any maybe control on the windows or inlet and outlet of the system. But the best one, or we haven't tested yet, because the test of each of these systems is very expensive. But anyway, we modeled this in some software and packages, and also we wrote a few codes for any of them. This has the best efficiency among all of the systems that I explained. Because, and we haven't included the transparent material and also natural light. If you look at that and add how much is the benefit of having natural light instead of electrical, maybe you have better performance for this as well. But we haven't included that in our calculation. Okay, the main idea is better. I try to don't put any formula and simulation or math in the system, but we need to talk about the numbers. If you look at the very papers in the literature, this is a lot. 40% of the world's total energy consumption is for building sector, 40%. And from this 40%, more than 60% is just for heating, ventilation, and cooling systems. And here we introduce a system just has capital cost, and this makes, I think, the feature and the view of the systems not that much bad, because if you look at those pictures, they put those systems in the tourism area in different city, and therefore I think the view of the city doesn't, you know, because for the, some mechanical system, if you go in the, I don't know, big cities like Toronto, and if you look at the top, then you have any chance to fly it, you know, on the Pearson Airport, you can see a lot of mechanical, like cooling towers, HVAC systems on top of the buildings. And they try to do the best in terms of the, you know, view of the systems, but doesn't make any sense to you that it's, but you have to do that. In some offices, in some industry, you have to do cooling, heating, and ventilation. But this system and our very preliminary results show that if we use the best natural systems, we have between 20 and 80%, and you may see there is a big, you know, kind of changes. Why 20%, why 80%, which one is true? That really depends on the weather condition and the load that you have. Maybe in some country like Canada, you need for cooling just, I don't know, 1 month or 2 months. But in some area, like as I mentioned in the southwest part of the US, in New Mexico or, I don't know, the other part, or the main city that I mentioned in Yazd, we need 6 months cooling. Therefore, 80% is a lot. But even 20% is something that some you know, companies are looking for that. 20% decrease in the electrical efficiency. And again, this is not included the natural light, which is very important for having kind of better situation. And also environmental pollution and green gas effect, greenhouse gas effect, emission, most of them can be added to these numbers. And this is the kind of wind map of the Canada. We have the chance to using this system based on this. The reference is here, windatlas.ca. And if you look at them, we don't have that much wind in most part of Iran or Middle East. But if you look at this, in some area, especially the east, there is a huge potential for having this system. And this is the very preliminary idea for having this in any part of the Canada that we are going to discuss with some companies or government here, sorry. If we use, as I mentioned, cap or dome and also the different, but again, this is the very, you know, preliminary idea. It's not final yet because you have to do, if you have more than two or three wind catchers of the system, you have to do optimization to find out what, where is the best places for putting each of them. But you can use in any big area like malls, industrial factories, complexes, and even educational campus, and use the benefit of this actually environment-friendly system. we can call that. And for both air conditioning and having natural light. If I want to conclude my talk in this slide and compare with other mechanical systems, I'm here to actually compare. I didn't put any other systems. Maybe some of you know that there are at least 10 or more than that different mechanical systems based on the electrical, chemical, and other use of chemicals to bring heat or cold air inside the system that we need. But if you have any specific question, we can compare that. But in summary, this system doesn't have any problem with the installation. If we have, if we do any, all of the process in the factory or in the industry, we may need just a few hours to install on the building. The maintenance cost almost is zero because they are working for, I don't know, 100 years without any. The idea is very important, but there is no sophisticated technology behind that. It comes all from the nature. The new idea was ability to rotating. It's very efficient, as I mentioned, based on the experiment. We don't need any electrical energy because it's like other passive systems. And as I showed you, combination of this wind tower with any kind of system that are using right now in most of the system and country, solar chimney or heater or any other wind tower, and also cap or dome or kola farangi, increase ventilation rate a lot. With transparent materials, we can use natural light. And also, if your idea is that, how can we use this for other part of the buildings? If I put this here, yes, we can use channels to transfer the air to the other part of the building. And very new idea in this is one company works right now is for the wind turbine. Is it possible, instead of putting turbines in different direction, is it possible to first catch the maximum amount of wind and then use it in a small turbine or not? This is the very new idea. Therefore, we can use kind of channel to transfer this amount of wind and air to any area that we need. But they are not limited to these ones. We can talk more about that and the detail and calculation. Thank you, and I'm here to ask to answer any question if you have.
Okay, so Q&A session. Any questions?
Would there be,
Sure.
In a lot of air handling systems, with regards to energy conservation, there are in houses, before air can be exhausted, there has to be a heat recapture from it with a heat recovery ventilator. Is there a possibility to integrate a system like that in the event of that kind of oversight?
The combination of wind tower and air handling unit.
Yeah, a heat recovery ventilator.
Yes. For example, we can use to decrease the amount of energy in those air handling units to bring first air, the fresh air that we need, to with a wind catcher, and then bring it into the air handling unit. Or even we can put some part of in very, that's not a wind catcher anymore, but we can use kind of combination of these to put some part of the air handling unit in the path of this process of wind turbine, wind catcher, for example, the coils of or the spray of the water, to do most of those processes inside the wind catcher. We can use that. Yeah, that's a good point. Sure.
Catches me is that when we talk about natural ventilation for buildings here, we have to be aware of the optimal conditions and particularly humidity entering the building. Have you given any thought to, I mean, I suspect that's not an issue where you've studied them in the past, have you given any thought to humidity entering the building and its impact on the systems in the building and the optimal conditions?
For the humidity. Yeah, that's a very good question. I didn't talk about the detail of this design, but as you mentioned, for the comfort condition, we have to look at thermodynamic properties like humidity, effective temperature, or the sensible temperature, and also the wet bulb and dry bulb temperatures. Therefore, we can put, like the air handling unit, we can put dehumidifier or other sections that we have in other mechanical system to control the humidity. And if you go to the literature many years ago, the people that use this system in very kind of wet area or the places that the wet bulb temperature and dry bulb temperature are very close, they use kind of cellulosar pad in the different part to absorb the amount part of the, you know, humidity during the, because we are not interested to bring that humidity inside the, but right now we have to be careful also about the erosion and corrosion that I mentioned if we are going to have. And also using kind of chemical is possible to absorb the amount of humidity. Sure.
Sanitary vent pipes and other things that extend to the roof where things are getting out of the building for a reason that don't necessarily want to get back in.
You mean about the return air that we should be careful about having it again suck in?
If it's something that's noxious that's being exhausted from the building.
Yeah, that's true. As because of that I mentioned, and we have this, for example, we in the mechanical system, as you know, we should have the inlet and outlet very far away from each other because we are not interested to have, especially for the polluted area or factory area or chemicals that we have, we are very careful about that. And yeah, that's right. Because of that, I mentioned we need to, that very simple idea, we need to be careful, maybe the critical, you know, distance between those, because some of them may again catch the polluted part of the air and bring it again inside the, yeah, that's very important. We have to look at that very carefully. And our simulation, final simulation or final test inside the big wind tunnel like the Western, looking at that, because we should be very careful. That's very important, because if you have two wind catcher and part of that is absorbing again the polluted or return air, is not good. And for that one, for sure, we will see a critical distance between some of them. Yeah, that's very important.
Simple matter of coordination, but
yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's a good point to finalize the design. That.
There's one here. What's the cooling potential for these towers, I guess? I mean, today's a good example. It's 40 degrees outside. We're sitting in a nice air-conditioned room, 22, 23 degrees. Can wind towers bridge that gap?
That's very good question, and maybe because of that, I invite some of you or all of you, if you have chance, to come to the Yazd. I am not sure, Bijan, have you been in Yazd or not? Because the if you go there, we have but very dry area. We have almost above 40 most of the summer, and all of them, as I showed in the very first picture here, you see. We have just this. And by the way, they have done very good job in some specific cases. The best one is in Kashan, Look at this city, okay? If you look at them, this is not very, very old, but there is no mechanical, because it doesn't, it's not possible to have that. When you don't have any water, how can you have air handling unit, you know? Because, or if you don't have that much power, how can you use the kind of window type air conditioner? But the system is not perfect for sure, but if you go inside the building and you see in most region like south part of this city, close to south part of Iran, you cannot come out in some afternoons. The temperature goes above 50 degrees of centigrade. But inside the building, at least you can go for sure around 60% of the cooling load that you need. But in some specific cases that I think it's very well known all around the world, in Kashan, for the very fashion building, it was palace, you know, many years ago, they used this kind of wind catcher, but the pass of the wind catcher, if I have any mark here, no, I don't have any. Okay.
Yeah, give me one sec. Let me go behind this.
Okay. They use this kind of system. Maybe it's interesting. If this is the place that I need to bring the wind here, they put kind of wind catcher here and catch the wind in a specific distance of the building, and then they bring it in a, if this is, for example, the level of the ground, they put very small amount of water, and when they catch the air by the wind catcher, the air comes through this distance, and because of this distance, we have a chance to have the combination of fresh air and the evaporative system. And this goes more than 70% of the load that you need. Because, for example, in the area like Tehran, we use just evaporative system. And you don't have any problem. For above 37 or 35 degrees, the inlet of the evaporative system is around 15, 18, 20. Therefore, you have around 20 degrees of centigrade for the evaporative system. And they used four of these systems around this very fancy, and you cannot believe that if you go, is it a mechanical system, is it an air conditioning, or is just a simple wind catcher combined with an evaporative system. It's in Kashan, 200 south of Tehran.
More questions? Nothing?
Small aesthetic note.
Sure.
The root word for window is wind eye. I thought you'd enjoy that, the idea of how you moderate your wind flow with windows.
Sorry, I didn't get your question.
It's just a,
ah, I see.
An aesthetic note.
Ah. Yeah.
Wind eye, you said, right?
Wind eye.
Wind eye.
Wind eye. Yeah, that's to catch the direction of the wind, you mean, yeah?
There's an architectural movement over the last 20 years, and not every building does it, but a lot of buildings are actually doing a second skin. To the building. And so there actually is a vertical plenum that goes all the way from the ground up to the roof. Does that have any application for this?
You know, it's not easy to, because again, depends on the place and the weather condition, because sometimes you have to be careful about the cooling and, you know, heating. Because maybe if you just look at one of them, you will find the best, you know, there are some programs and softwares you can design, for example, this building, and then rotate it, you know, by different angles to see what's the minimum load. But again, you should be careful, the minimum load of heating or the minimum load of cooling. And which one, because approximately the cooling load, as you know, is four times expensive, more expensive than the heating load. And we should be, you know, optimized. It's very, it's not easy problem at least to have the best different, you know, characteristics like windows, you know, roof, direction, and combine them with the cooling load and heating load and optimize them. It's a very, at least you need to look at different variables. But it's very kind of scientific or very top research plan because of too many variables and parameters. As much as I know, I don't know. Maybe we can look at the literature more carefully to see. But it's not easy to just answer in a...
Yeah, I know when it comes to heating and cooling losses, it's the number of occupants, then the type of insulation you're using, the direction. So there are so many independent variables involved that would impact your dependent variable.
Yeah.
I completely agree.
Yeah, for example, another parameter that they just added this year, days, is the everything which you considered except the air pollution, which is very effective for sun. The solar beam of the sun, it is different in very clean area and very polluted area. If you don't look at that carefully, your calculation is, you know, different from the reality. Therefore, we have too many variables and parameters. But for sure, it's a good idea to look at them and good question in terms of, you know, research.
Question. More questions, if you like.
Sure.
One is another initiative, again, it's been going on for about 20 years in the mainstream, is the use of green roofs to provide cooling, given the amount of heat that is generated on the ground.
You know, the geothermal.
It's all paving now. There is no green. So they're hoping to use the roof to provide that compensating element, except for the fact that green roofs are very, very expensive. And I don't know how much per dollar a green roof is a benefit as far as cooling goes compared to how much the development of wind towers would be to providing it. How it would become a competition, actually.
Yeah.
As far as value.
Yeah, I haven't checked the green roofs yet in different systems, but for sure in terms of load, again, it's very, you know, effective at the first glance. But per cost, I don't have any idea if we put that, how many years, you know, the payback is possible for in terms of the saving of the energy. We should that. Look at that more carefully, I don't know. But in terms of load, that's very effective. For sure, we know that. But in terms of cost and payback, I have no idea.
And the last question I have is, I've got all the dynamics of this backwards because I keep thinking of all the heat that's on the ground getting up and away. When in fact, the wind towers, they capture wind up here and direct it down. But what's happening in cities is that the ground plane is very hot because of all the asphalt. And is there any way to use a passive form like this, like a non-mechanical form, to in fact provide cooling of the outside, like not the building, but to do more to actually cool off the without using water on the ground?
I know. There are some systems in the, at least because of the humidity in the north part of Iran, we don't make the building on the ground because of the too much, actually water is, the humidity is 100% because you have to make your, you know, building on the water. Therefore, they make a distance between that, and that's if you put a lot of kind of a small or mid-sized stone there in the nighttime, they call it saved cooling. The cooling of the nighttime can be saved on inside those stones. And then during the daytime, if you have kind of flow of the air around that, you have better air in terms of temperature with the air, fresh air coming out from the environment. Yeah, we have some. And but the combination of that, we have a lot of with the water. But without water, I have just seen this system, and this is used in many part of the other countries, I believe. I have seen a few reports and papers. Yeah, we call it cooling saving systems for that one. And again, that's passive. For the active one, for sure, we don't need in the nighttime that cooling.
I guess that's it. So I would like to thank Dr. Majid Sultani for his wonderful presentation and visit to University of Waterloo. On behalf of University of Waterloo community and Waterloo Institute for Sustainable Energy, thank you so much.
Thank you.